Oh, no doubt about it. Because you go to people you trust.
Yes.
And if I smack anybody right now, they're not going to trust me. Like, oh, yeah, I like her. No, they're going to go call the police or want to fight you back. So, I mean, it's one of those things where we need to breathe life into them and give them power and help them steer their
way. But, you know, nowadays, look like kids got a little bit more power than we have. Because if you beat a kid today, somebody going to pick up a phone and the kid go up here. And, you know, they all come equipped with cell phones now and call the police or have the police come over there and take the child away from the home. And, you know, they got to go through the court system. You know, that's something else again.
That's something that can happen, but it's something that does not really happen. I talk to, well, it can happen, but I enough young people come to me, teenagers alike, and look at the objects on that book and say, oh, I get hit with this, I get hit with that, I get hit with that. So our children still get beat, and they're not calling anybody because you love your mom. You don't want to see your mom incarcerated or your dad incarcerated. So it still goes on, but whether we got incarcerated or not, we need to not be bringing violence to ourselves. The brother that you had on earlier talked about the guys shooting themselves, shooting, beating up people and putting it on. That violence comes from what they learned when they were young. It comes from not being able to express yourself in any other way and not understanding. What we don't understand is that the brain develops at 4 years old, regulatory equipment. It's where the brain develops to make good choices, and they don't have that.
But also, too, that brain stops going at 10 years old too, and they have a mind of their own after that too.
Well, that part of the brain doesn't develop. That's the point. When there's stress involved, and when they're like 4 years old, that part of the brain doesn't develop because of the stress we put in it.
Orlando, do me a favor. Put a camera on Ramon Smith for a minute.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Ramon.
Yes, sir.
Thank you for coming. Appreciate it. What is your opinion about this?
My opinion, I'm a parent myself, so my opinion regarding that, I don't think it's wise to physically harm children. I do understand that there may be a time. That said, I mentioned earlier, because I had a great opportunity to have a small discussion with Asada, I think that when you reduce yourself to physical violence to your child for discipline, you've either run out of ideas or you've run out of patience. And the great way to be a parent, or to be the best parent that you're capable of being, is to increase your sense of patience and look for the understanding behind the behavior. Personally, I use the carrot and stick approach with my child, and that works.
Do you beat your child?
No. However, have I done it? Once or twice. But as a practice of discipline, no.
It doesn't work, correct?
It doesn't work. Oh. It doesn't.
Ms. Joseph, you work with young people, right?
Yes.
Put a camera on Ms. Joseph Orlando. What's your opinion?
I tend to agree that physical form of discipline should not be the cost taken by parents and caregivers when it comes to disciplining children. However, it is okay for us to sit and talk and say that, you know, we should not do this and we should not do that. For us as a people, we have to give some people something if we're telling them that you can't do, you shouldn't do this form of discipline. And it's easy to say that we can't get the patients and so forth. But who out there is willing to work with the parent to actually to get them to that point so that they overcome their maybe their own physical abuse that they may have experienced in the past, and to get them to the point where now they can use a different, more effective method of disciplining the children. So while we say that, it is good to say that, but we have to give people something that they can use in its place.
Thank you, so much. Give her a big hand. You had stopped children on the train.
Sure.
And everybody came to almost the one everybody event. If you're not physically, you don't want to do it, don't do this. Mm-hmm. Because I'm not going to have a lawsuit. Because I said this, I just said anything. But you're your own person, and you had stopped kids, you know, on the train, and you know, and. And well, if you're living in New York, that number 3 train can be rough.
It's all good. All the way to East New York.
Well, go ahead.
That's right.
That's the dinner conductor. Go ahead. But you said you had stopped some children, you had disciplined some brothers about wearing their pants or something.
I mean, sure. I mean, you know, what it takes to handle a subject like this is to handle the layers, creates layers. And so, yes, I've spoken to young people on the train about their conduct, and I do it, you know, I don't embarrass them. That's the main thing. People embarrass them, and they speak out loud. But I get in their space and I communicate with them. But
you take like over like the side of the confidence, right?
Oh, confidence and love. It's bottom line.
Yeah, I mean, you don't sit back and tell them, put up your pants or something like that.
Yeah, I'm not interested in giving them some kind of punitive message. I'm interested in communicating with them so they can change and be concerned about what they're displaying to me. I tell them, you don't know who I am or who these people are. I could have a job for you right now. What is my first impression? And they go, oh, I should pull my pants up. So, you know, it's good. I mean, they understand.
First impression, yeah, last impression.
But nobody will communicate with them. But I think more importantly, I talk to parents. Like the sister said, I do talk to those parents because sometimes that frustration we see on the train and smacking the kids, they just need somebody to come in, intervene, and have a conversation with them about the frustration they're feeling at that time, and then give them alternatives. And it has worked wonderfully, and that's what I did in the book. I put solutions all throughout the book, marked by little keys, like there are keys all throughout the book that help people see what to do and how to think.
I would like to thank you very much.
Sure.
We would like to bring you back another day to expand a little bit more. Okay, yeah. I know you have a flight to go out and everything like that, and we thank you for taking time out to come to see us on the LMS show.
Thank you. Asada, and I'm the author of Beating Black Kids. Definitely check it out at beatingblackkids.com.
Okay, give her a big hand, and we'll see you right back. We're back with the LMS show. Oh my goodness, what a topic. We got another topic coming up. Met this young lady. In fact, the Sisters Uptown Book Club had a book signing, and they were reading this book, right?
Right.
And what is your name, my friend?
Evels.
And give Evels a big hand, everybody. It's like, you know, we're shedding books, but this has a message too. Tell us a bit about yourself.
Yeah. Well, I'm a banker, but I've always wanted to write. So, growing up, I would write diaries and poems and things like that. And I finally decided to publish a book.
Did you publish yourself?
Yes.
Why?
Because the literary world is pretty hard to get into, and after trying for a number of years, I just started reading about self-publishing, and I did it. And I figured if I don't do it now, I'm never going to do it.
Well, give a big hand behind that. So you just did it yourself, right?
I just did it. I just took the plunge, and I published it.
What is this book about?
Okay, now, you know how you always read romance novels, and everybody in the book is beautiful and young and perfect bodies and, you
wow.
know. So I said to myself, you know what? When you get to be older, love doesn't stop. Great sex doesn't stop. Attraction doesn't stop. So I wrote this book with the target audience of middle-aged and older women so that they can see you don't have to be perfect. To,
you know, this ass too, right?
Yes, I mean, you don't have to be perfect. You don't have to be a size 4. You don't have to be beautiful to experience passion.
You don't have to be Mustang either, right?
Exactly. So the thing is about the story is these two people tried not to get together because they were both married to other people.
Oh.
Yeah, so it gets complicated, which happens in life, and you get to, you know, they got to be friends, but the twister is they knew each other in another life.
Oh, in a past life?
Yes.
Okay.
When they met, they instantly recognized each other, even though they didn't know, they had a feeling that they knew each other. So, but they started out as friends because they were commuting together. You know, so they met on the train. After a couple of years, you know, the electricity just, so they got together. But with a tremendous amount of guilt, of course, because they were both married and married for a long time, and with kids.
Well, is this a friction book? Did you base this on? Do you have experiences?
Well,
with
you
this?
See, I have this kind of thing that people tell me things. Even people that I just meet, they tell me, and through the years, a lot of my girlfriends went through similar circumstances. So I put it all together and I wrote about it.
What is their reaction with this book?
People actually love it because it's like a fresh take on romance novels. When the ladies read it here at the book club, they loved it, and I was very pleased.
They're a hard crowd.
Yeah, they're a hard crowd.
You know, you either get Apollo Pride or Wednesday night amateur night or something else.
But the book has sadness in it because, you know, with the guilt that the couples felt, it was very hard to keep this romance going. And so in the end, of course, it fell apart. But, well, I'm not going to tell you.
No, but read, I can't say buy the book or the end because I'm going to come back and say, read the book.
Read the book.
Read the book, everybody, and then you'll get the gist. You went through a lot of personal experience yourself. Tell me about you.
I was married a couple of times. Actually, I'm on my third marriage.
On the third, okay.
Wow. Well, I got married at 18, and you know, at 18, you don't know anything. And, you know, I mean, he was nice and everything, but he turned out to be an alcoholic, and I didn't know. I had no experience with that. I've never seen an alcoholic. I didn't know anything about it.
How about the second one?
The second one was totally different. You know, opposites attract, but if you're not on the same page, it falls apart. 25 years, though, I was married.
Oh.
Try to keep it.
Wait, 25 years?
Yes.
Because I don't want to say, so you know what happened to 10-year mom?
Yeah, well.
You collect SS.
So I put an end to it because I figured, you know, you're getting older, you want to be happy, you can't waste your life, you know.
Are you happy now?
I'm happy now, yes. Because I met someone who we're very much alike.
Yeah.
And that's the thing.
Yeah. You have children.
I have four.
How many children? How old are they?
They're grown. They're all grown. My baby's 32.
32? Yeah. Oh, okay. God bless her.
Yeah, I'm a grandmother. I'm a great grandmother.
Oh!
Yeah.
Your opinion about Sisters Books, Uptown Bookstore, they're nice people.
I love this place. Are you kidding? The ladies here treated me like they've known me forever. I was a little nervous the first time I came here, but as soon as they started talking, I just relaxed. And they treat you like you're one of their own. I just love it here. So, very comfortable here.
I would like to thank you very much for joining us today on the LMS show.
Thank
and, you know, we go to end it off. We, you know, remember Isaac Hayes?
Oh, sure.
I remember...
Hot
Butter Soul. But no, the one that really made him. Well, he was producing on Writing Samples, Sammy Dave, everybody else. The Blacklist movie, remember those black movies that come out back in the 70s, you know, Superfly and Shaft and all this, you know.
The Mac.
Isaac Hayes won an award, a Cappy Award. Not for the Mac, but he won Cappy Award for this particular show. The famous song, Shaft, remember?
Shaft.
And we're going to hear Shaft right now, and we'll see you soon with more of LMS and Take It Down.
Dick, that's a sex machine.